They're one of Arkansas's largest sport fish.
Well, they just don't want to quit.
Hook into one of these brutes, and you'll feel like your line's been tied to a runaway Cadillac.
It's hard to move him.
Welcome to deep sea fishing in landlocked Arkansas.
There you go. That's number one. Let's try to get more.
Striped bass offer some of the natural state's most exciting fishing, allowing anglers to experience the thrill of saltwater fishing without leaving home.
The striped bass are an ocean fish. And in the late 50s, they learned out in South Carolina the Santee Cooper system. When they were constructing dams out there, they realized that they had landlocked some of these striped bass. And not only did they live in the freshwater, but they also prospered. They do grow to trophy potential, so we can have fish that get upwards of 50 pounds and provide a real unusual fishing opportunity.
Stripers came to Arkansas lakes in 1956 when the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission began stocking them in large upland reservoirs built by the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. The fish thrived, but fisheries managers soon realized striped bass couldn't spawn naturally. That marked the birth of the Game and Fish Commission's Striped Bass Spawning Project. And 6 decades later, it's still going strong.
She's ready to spawn, boys.
The Game and Fish Commission's Andrew Hulsey State Fish Hatchery conducts the Striped Bass Spawning Project each spring, producing about 450,000 fish a year that are released in Arkansas lakes. From the collection of adult fish on Lake Ouachita to the stocking of fingerling stripers, fisheries managers dedicate a lot of time and attention to producing the natural state's version of deep sea denizens.
Each year in mid-April, when the water temperature is appropriate, we come up to the Denby area. We know the habits of the fish, and at that time of the year, we're going to have those fish move into that area. So we'll come in with gill nets, commercial tackle. We'll set those gill nets just before dark and then run them for several hours afterward. And those stripers, we just rely on their natural movements, which they do keep moving in loose schools. And if we have a good night, you know, we might be able to put 15, 20 fish on the fish truck. So we'll put a sufficient number of those striped bass onto the truck, transport them back to Hulsey Hatchery.
717. One I just put in there is a MS 222, which is an anesthetic. Keeps them calm because these fish don't do well and when they're getting hauled in, you know, small spaces.
To make this project happen, we have to rely on outside sources. We can't merely pull this off with help from our management district just combined with the hatchery. We have to rely a lot on other folks in our fisheries division to come in from the four corners of the state to assist us with this project.
It's all hands on deck with game and fish crews working around the clock.
And it's a 24/7 at this point. The crew takes over. We've still got netting going on for several consecutive nights, and we're bringing these fish to the building, and then we start trying to spawn the fish.
Much like a hospital's labor and delivery ward, the hatchery takes on an expectant air as everyone waits for nature to take its course.
When they get close to spawning, they're a lot more docile.
That process is monitored by the hatchery staff, taking a little glass capillary tube and inserting it into the vent of the females and getting an egg sample. We see how close those eggs are to actual ovulation or at the point where a ripe egg is ready to be released.
Once these eggs get clear with a well-defined nucleus, you know, that just shows that they're getting closer to being ready to spawn. You got to keep track of these fish. That's when we use the yarn tags on them. We know when to check them and keep record of when they spawn.
So when we do have a female ready to release her ripe eggs, they're basically just squeezed into a pan and milk from the males. The sperm is squeezed on top of the eggs and they are pan fertilized.
Basically what we're doing, we just want to move these eggs around so they can have more of an opportunity to come in contact with the sperm. We do this for a couple of minutes and then we'll decant all this water off and they'll go straight into the jar.
Generally we put 1/3 cups into a jar, which is around 150,000 eggs.
The eggs stay in these specialized hatching jars, tumbling gently for 3 or 4 days before hatching.
A newly hatched striper, at first they're going to have a yolk sac that they have to absorb. That's their first food supply. And until their mouth parts are developed, which does take several days after hatching, only at that time are they ready to seek their own food.
The fry spend 4 days in these indoor tanks until they're ready to move to the hatchery's outdoor ponds.
What we'll do is we'll pull the tank down to where we can get the fry out of the tank. We'll get 250,000 out of here, putting that stocking barrel to go to one of our fry ponds to be stocked this morning.
We'll take those little tiny fry and put them over into that pond, and then they're ready to seek their own food, which will be the small plankton that they can actually get in their mouth.
This will be their new home for the next 2 to 3 months. This weighted barrel slowly sinks, tempering the fry. It'll take about 45 minutes for it to drop. That way it lets them get used to the water chemistry and the temperature of the pond. Gives them a better chance of survival.
The next step is patience. It takes 2.5 to 3 months for the fish to reach the desired size for stocking in Arkansas lakes. And then, there's even more work in store for the crew at the Hulsey Hatchery.
5.5.
The hatchery grows the fish in outdoor ponds for 10 to 12 weeks until they reach about 2 inches in length, which is known in aquaculture circles as a fingerling.
And at that time, they're going to be ready to put onto fish trucks and move to their respective receiving location.
But first, there's some hot, muddy, manual labor for the hatchery crew.
6.9.
The harvesting process is distinctly old school, changing little since the program started in the 1950s. Crews use seine nets to corral the fingerling stripers, carefully surrounding the fish as they draw the net together. They scoop the small fish into waiting buckets, and a bucket brigade moves the fish from the ponds to the fish trucks.
4.6.
Weighing each bucket of fish allows the crew to estimate the number of fish going onto the truck. Harvesting the fish as fingerlings allows the hatchery to produce more fish for Arkansas anglers.
They're plenty strong for good survival in the waters. We can't hold them in the ponds for extended periods to grow them into the fall. We could run into water quality problems. We could run into parasite problems.
The fish are now ready for their journey to one of Arkansas's striped bass lakes. The stripers on this truck are making a 26-mile road trip to the Brady Mountain area of Lake Ouachita.
They're pulled up to the boat ramp, and we'll temper the water to make sure it's as close to lake temperature as possible. Also, gets the chemistry of the water somewhat the same to enhance their survival, and we'll release those fish. Today, we've been trying something a little bit different. We have several interested striped bass guides here at Lake Ouachita, and they wanted to assist the Game and Fish, come out and help us any way they could to put these fish over into the lake. So we've added a step, and we've had these anglers meet us here at the boat ramp. These boat ramps are inhabited by a lot of little brim, long-eared sunfish, and little yearling bass that would probably take a toll on some of the very small fingerlings that are released at the boat ramp. So we're just trying to give them a little extra advantage and let our anglers that want to assist take these fish out into the open water away from the shoreline and some of those predators.
Swim, baby, swim.
Whether they're released from a fish truck or stocked in deeper water by volunteers, striped bass couldn't exist in Arkansas lakes without the Game and Fish Commission's annual spawning project.
The striped bass offer another opportunity out there, that trophy fish potential, and they're not hurting the other fisheries. So we can exist and we can have a black bass fishery on Lake Ouachita as well as offer striped bass fishing. There are several guides on this lake that are supported by the striped bass, and we have folks come in from states away just to fish striped bass on Lake Ouachita.
It's a chance to experience the thrill of marine fishing right here in Arkansas.